One step beyond.
Hello, meat lovers. Hello, vegetarians. We need to talk about the future of meat. Because although many people are aware that global warming is an issue, less people are aware that meat production contributes to a lot of these greenhouse gases heating our planet. Aren't we just consuming too much? We cut away rainforests to grow soy, to feed animals, while on other parts of the planet, people still don't have enough food. And then I haven't even discussed the issues around animal welfare and animal diseases. So towards the future, I believe there are four options. Option number one is that we continue to eat as much meat as we do today, and then in 2050, when there are 9 billion people on the planet, we need another planet. Option two is that you can become a vegetarian. Are there vegetarians in the room today? May I have an applause for these most sustainable people? This is the most sustainable thing you can do. And notice also that I did not raise my hand. I love to eat meat, although I am ambivalent about it. I want to explore all options. So we should also eat more insects, really, especially in the western part of the world. Those grasshoppers, they're really not that different from shrimps. And then there's the fourth option, the option beyond, I would say. It's a new option. To grow meat in a different way, in vitro, to grow meat in the lab. And this is what I want to talk about today. Allow me to explain the process to you. It's quite simple. You take some cells from an animal, and rather than growing the entire animal, you only grow these cells into muscle tissue, you feed them, and then in the end, you turn that muscle tissue into your familiar hamburger. This idea is not new. In fact, already almost 90 years ago, Winston Churchill told us that we shall escape the absurdity of growing a whole chicken in order to eat the breast or the wing by growing these parts separately under a suitable medium. The first patent was filed in 1999 by Willem van Eelen, now known also as the godfather of in vitro meat. And in 2013, the first in vitro meat hamburger was cooked and presented by Professor Mark Post. It only cost 250,000 euros though. Yet as we speak, companies in the Netherlands, in the US, in Israel, in China are racing to bring that price down and to replace the sausages, burgers, and steaks of today with a more sustainable and animal-friendly version. This period in time reminded me a little bit about the introduction of the first car, the horseless carriage. We know it, right? When the first car was introduced, it was presented as this horseless carriage. People didn't know what an automobile was, let alone that they expected seat belts, driver licenses, traffic jams, speed limits, an energy problem. But every new technology not only brings us new products, but also new habits and new cultures. So I believe that before we can decide if we want to eat meat from the lab, we have to explore the food culture it may bring us. I sat down with biotechnologists, with chefs, and worked on this very special product, the world's first in vitro meat cookbook. 45 recipes you cannot cook yet. I will show you some of the dishes from the book here. One thing you immediately think about is if it's too difficult to 3D print a steak, but you could make thin threads and grow them, then you could have this new ritual in the kitchen where grandmother is knitting the meat. That's the first application. Something else you may think of when you grow meat in the lab, you will do this under very controlled circumstances. It's much cleaner than a butcher. So you could maybe make transparent sushi or sashimi that is softer, healthier, and basically better than the best sushi you ever tasted. You could also grow it locally. This we call honest from the lab. What you see here is a locally grown tapas combined with a local beer. Really, making cheese, brewing beer, growing meat, it's not that different. Of course, growing meat is rather new, but they all are about manipulating cell cultures. And maybe you will do it one day in your own kitchen, that you have this kitchen table bio-incubator device in your kitchen where you will be hunting and remixing animal cells. So today we pick some fish and some deer. You combine them, and in the meat synthesizer, you set the tenderness just a little bit more tender. You wait for some 3 days in the kitchen tabletop incubator, and then, ta-da! You have your tuna deer steak grown in your own kitchen. Will this happen? One more dish. You might also use it to grow this, and it looks like a very familiar sausage, but it's made from a very special pig called Pookie, that lives in the city farm nearby. We take some cells from Pookie, we grow the sausage. You can feed the sausage to your child, and then the next day you can bring your child to the city farm, and there's Pookie! He's alive! We didn't have to slaughter the animal to grow the meat. Now, this would radically change our consumptive attitude to animals. As a vegetarian, would you eat it? Because, yeah, maybe one day chefs will be serving victimless foie gras. And how exclusive will that be anyhow then? We also have hybrids between meat and fruit. Here you see the meat fruit. It has a structure of fruit, but a very meaty taste, which makes it a nice amuse. Or one step further, these are the synthetic organisms from the in vitro aquarium. They are hybrids between plants and animals. They move, but they don't have a central nervous system, and they do not feel pain. So, without any guilt, you put them fresh on the teppanyaki plate. Are we still okay with this? Because I understand that some of the dishes I show you, they're a bit weird. And I have to add that my method is not to predict the future, that we cannot do anyhow, but rather to be a radar for potential futures, make them very tangible, both the dreams and the nightmares, in order to better decide what future we actually want. And when you design in this space, quite quickly you think, okay, we can use cells from chicken, cow, a pig, a fish perhaps, but you could also use human cells. What you see here, these are the celebrity cubes. If Justin Bieber, Lady Gaga, or Usain Bolt would be willing to donate only a few cells to us, we could grow this into a nice celebrity snack. Or one step further even, that you would use your own cells. Here you see a very futuristic, I have to add, but you would have a small bio incubator on your own body, and you would grow a medallion of meat there. In about 3 months' time, you grow the meat, and then you harvest the meat from your body, and you will serve this meat in a very intimate dish to a loved one. Who thinks this is beautiful and poetic? Who thinks this is absolute horror still? Yeah, I see more hands. Okay, well, we can have a discussion about it. Besides the cookbook, I also wanted to make a restaurant, and this became the Bistro In Vitro. I was inspired by the world's best restaurants. I looked at them, and you have, for instance, in Copenhagen, you have this restaurant called Noma. Also near Barcelona, you had this restaurant, what El Bulli, very experimental. It's closed now, but at the summit of its success, 1 million people every year wanted to dine in this restaurant. 1 million requests per year, and they could only facilitate 8,000 diners. I wonder, are there people in the room who dined at El Bulli? There's one person here. Well, you are this lucky 0.8% of the people that aspires to eat there, but you actually went, and congratulations, because all the others, like the 99.2% of the other people, we are basically consuming images. We heard about it, we've seen it, but we never tasted it. And this brought me to an idea to bring this to the next level. So to create a restaurant that serves 100% images. This became Bistro in Vitro, which is a traveling exhibition that is now traveling the world. And in this exhibition, you see these future dishes and can have a feeling about it, a discussion around it. So we have the burger, we have the celebrity cubes, we have this meat flour. That's interesting because often vegetarian alternatives try to mimic meat, but I thought we can also do that the other way around. If you like red wine, maybe you want a meat oyster with it. Or you could pick these protein bars, which are more sober. And they might also be distributed in areas of the world where people do not have enough protein sources. And this also we worked at on the website, because the Bistro in Vitro has a website. You can visit it, and there you can select your favorite menu, a starter, a main course, and a dessert. And depending on your choices, we will make a personalized in vitro meat profile for you. So it could be that you are a green Gandhi, that you focus on social, sober, sustainable solutions. Or maybe you are this extreme connoisseur, always searching for the most exquisite experimental experiences. There are 9 profiles, and it turns out that most of us are cuddly carnivores. We love animals. We also love meat, and we're kind of ambivalent about it. Visit Bistro in Vitro and find out what your profile is. We take reservations from 2028. And until 2028, we strictly serve food for thought. I don't want to leave you with an empty stomach, so I brought some dessert. Today I brought some meat ice. It has this very savory taste, and we have 6 different flavors. It's finally we have an ice cream now for grown-ups. The cart is here today. It will be in the foyer later, and you can all get a tasting, compile your menu, and discuss the future of meat. Bon appétit.